Let me read to you a passage from the 8th chapter of St. Mark's Gospel, verses 27 to 33. It's the Gospel for Thursday of the 6th week in Ordinary Time. St. Mark writes, Jesus and his disciples went on to the villages around Caesarea Philippi. On the way he asked them, Who do people say I am? They replied, Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others one of the prophets. But what about you, he asked, who do you say I am? Peter answered, You are the Christ. Jesus warned them not to tell anyone about him. He then began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things, and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and that he must be put to death, and after 3 days rise again. He spoke plainly about this, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But when Jesus turned and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter. Get behind me, Satan, he said. You do not have in mind the things of God, but the things of men. That's from Mark chapter 8, verses 27 to 33. It speaks of the person of Christ being at the center of things. What do I mean? Well, consider the patriarch Abraham, our father in the faith, as St. Paul calls him. His life's work was to enter into a personal covenant with the Lord, leaving his homeland in obedience to the divine call, and settling in the land indicated to him from above. The focus of his life was the Lord, the God of his personal life, with whom he now had a personal covenant. If anyone were to have asked him, Who do people say you are? He would have thought that a very secondary and even irrelevant question. What mattered to him was not who people said he was, but who the Lord was, and the promises he had given in his covenant. The same could be said of Isaac and Jacob. What mattered was their God, the God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob, and their descendants. Centuries later, at the rise of Moses, the God of the patriarchs and their descendants became, formally speaking, the God of a chosen people, the Hebrews. A covenant was established between God and a chosen people, not just certain chosen individuals. Moses could be said to be the human architect of this transition. As with Abraham, so with Moses, if anyone were to have asked who he, Moses, was, Moses would have regarded this as a very secondary and even irrelevant question. The important thing was who Yahweh was, and the covenant he had established with his chosen people. As with Abraham, the patriarchs, and Moses, so it was with the prophets. They bore witness to the reality of Yahweh God and the requirements of his covenant with his people. Especially binding was the first of all the commandments of this covenant, for there were to be no gods venerated by the people other than he, the Lord. And so we think of Elijah, Elisha, Isaiah, Jeremiah, and the rest, right up to John the Baptist. When the scribes and Pharisees came to John asking who he was, John said in effect, I am no one and nothing. I am a mere voice crying in the wilderness, prepare a way for the Lord. The important question was not who I am, but who he is. He, the one who is coming. The Hebrew scriptures and the Hebrew tradition all bear witness to the one important reality, the God of the covenant. He, the Lord, it is who matters. But something entirely new appeared on the scene with Jesus Christ. In his well-known book, A Rabbi Talks with Jesus, a 161-page work published in 1993, Rabbi Jacob Neusner imagines having a dialogue with a Jewish master of Christ's era about the teaching of Jesus. What did Jesus leave out of the Torah? He asked. Nothing was the answer. Then what did he add? Himself was the answer. So that was the great addition which Jesus Christ brought to the Torah, according to Nusna and Pope Benedict in his first volume of his work on Jesus Christ, took up Nusna's point. Nusna concluded that Jesus must be rejected for abandoning the Torah, while Pope Benedict writes that Nusna, the Jew, has helped to bring out the absolutely distinctive thing about Jesus Christ and his teaching. At the heart of Christ's revelation is the revelation about himself. He is the object of the gospel. He is the heart and soul of revelation. The entire scriptures point to him, and not just to a certain teaching contained in or even added to the Torah. His very person is what has been added. As St. Paul wrote, "This is the mystery now revealed, Christ in you, your hope of glory." Our gospel today from Mark chapter 8 verses 27 to 33 is one of the high points of our Lord's public ministry. Our Lord does not ask his disciples what people say he is teaching. He does not ask them, for instance, what are the scribes and Pharisees saying that I teach about the Sabbath observance? He does not ask, for instance, what are the common people saying is the essence of my teaching on the kingdom of God? He wants to know, rather, who do people say that I am? That is the important thing. And it is clearly the important thing as we read all four Gospels. Jacob Nusna could see this with all clarity, and gradually the scribes and Pharisees saw it too. Jesus of Nazareth went to his death above all because of who he claimed to be. "Are you the Christ, the Son of the living God?" the high priest asked him under oath. Our Lord replied, after maintaining silence in the face of all the other questions and accusations, he replied that he was, and that they would see him coming on the clouds of heaven at the right hand of God. At this he was sentenced to death. The Christian religion is not just the acceptance of and obedience to revealed teaching on how we are to live. The Christian religion is the acceptance of a person, the person of Jesus Christ, as the Son of God and Son of Man, Savior of the world and source of redemption and the sanctification of man. Our whole life is a vocation to know, love, and serve Jesus Christ, so as to see and enjoy him forever in heaven. It is commonly thought that to be a good Christian, one must be kind and charitable, and that is the end of it. But no, to be a true Christian, one must accept Christ's teaching about himself, and then base one's entire life, whatever be the cost, on this acceptance.